Good morning. My name is Martin Wachs. I'm a professor emeritus. And though I retired from the university 12 years ago, I cannot literally retire because in my field, transportation planning, the rate of change, the new innovations, the excitement is greater now than at any time since I started in the field. And the excitement is kind of centered on the issues of smart, adding things like Uber and Lyft and soon automated vehicles to the transportation mix, and sustainable, dealing with greenhouse gas emissions as well as the traditional pollutants that are the externalities of transportation. We try so hard to increase accessibility, to make the city more usable, more accessible to lower income people, to diverse people, and at the same time, we need to reduce the impact that it's having on our climate and on the quality of life in the cities. And in California, where we have done so much to address the stationary sources of carbon and of other pollutants, it turns out that the transportation system is emerging as one of the largest contributors to greenhouse gas emissions. And it varies from place to place in the world, but in our state, it's on the order of 40% of the carbon emissions are coming from transportation. And as we ratchet down and make measurable progress in transportation with respect especially to passenger transportation, cars and public transit, the way we're shaping the city is also actually increasing goods movement and resulting in large concentrations of distribution centers on the edge of the metropolitan region with heavy trucks making an increasing number of our trips, and they're harder to control in terms of the environment. So it's a really challenging puzzle, an interesting time. And we have a distinguished panel who are going to address some of these issues, and of course, when the panelists complete their remarks, we'll all have a chance to join them. And the first panelist will be Robert Cervero, who is the chair of the Department of City and Regional Planning at the University of California at Berkeley, and will, at the end of this academic year, join me as an emeritus professor, and presumably, like me, will continue to be involved in these issues over the coming decade or two. The fact that he's soon to become an emeritus is especially dramatic for me because he was my student here 36 years ago. I remember when I first met him going home and saying to my wife, if I'm ever famous someday, it'll be because I was Robert Cervero's teacher. And that has come true. He is in this field of sustainability and transportation. He's one of the leading scholars in the world. In addition to being the chair of the Department of City and Regional Planning at Berkeley and being the director of the University of California Transportation Center, he is probably better known for his scholarship in the relationship between land use, the environment, urban form, and travel. And just to mention a few of his qualifications, not mentioning his many publications, for example, he chairs the International Association of Urban Environments and is on the National Advisory Board of the Active Living Research Program for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. He serves on the advisory board of the Future of Urban Development Initiative and the World of the World Economic Forum. He's on the U.S. EPA's Scientific Board of Counselors, and he's a member of the American Planning Association's Emerging Issues Task Force. He was a contributing author of the recent IPCC document on climate change. So he's very well qualified to address these issues. And it's my pleasure to call upon Robert Cervero.
I thought the best way I could organize my talk is to use this very simple framework here called the ASI framework, which has been advanced by the sustainable transportation community, how to create future cities and transportation systems where we can shrink the carbon footprint. And this is pretty straightforward. The A stands for avoid. How can we design cities, maybe not to avoid travel, but to sort of shorten trip distances, to bring trip origins and destinations closer. So people might drive less and walk or bike or take alternative modes. So pretty straightforward. And of course, how do we shift? How do we invest more in alternative green infrastructure, bicycle infrastructure, better public transit systems, and so forth, and of course, innovate. Clean fuel technology, how do we use IT information technologies to squeeze efficiencies. But a lot of this collectively, what it adds up to is trying to reduce the vehicle kilometers traveled per capita and really hopefully reduce wasted commuting and make cities cleaner and greener and more productive and happier people. So it's that very broad agenda. So let me kind of jump right into this, avoid. Well, you know, we have vast literature that shows how we design cities does have a fairly profound effect on travel, and I kind of like to use this little image here. This actually came out of a book I co-wrote a couple years ago called Transforming Cities with Transit. You can take a city like Curitiba, Brazil, which is well known as a fabulously planned city with great public transport. It actually has lower densities than a city like Sao Paulo, which is a much bigger city. But they're planned densities. They're what we call articulated densities. They're linear densities, and they really channel a lot of traffic along these high-capacity, high-quality transit corridors. So you get many more public transit trips per capita in a much smaller city like Curitiba, vis-a-vis a place like Sao Paulo, which has kind of piecemeal ad hoc development scattered in all directions. And according to the World Bank, the congestion costs per person are much lower. So planning does matter. It's not just the density. What you find in a place like Curitiba is along these linear corridors, they intermix land uses. So you have housing, offices, retail, schools, many of the activities along these linear corridors. And what that means is in the peak hour, you get bidirectional flows. So some people are making this trip, other people at the same time are making this trip, and you sort of intersplice these multi-directional flows. So what that means are the buses are pretty much full in both directions, you know, versus a city where the jobs are here and housing's here and everything's jam-packed in one direction and the roads and buses and trains are empty the other direction. So it's not just density, it's the planning and the chemistry and the mixture of use. Let me talk just another example of a void, and this is really a topic I've been studying for the last 30 years in suburban development, and there's been a fairly significant movement of how do we take these master plan single-use suburban environments, think shopping mall or something like a massive business office park where 98% of the floor space is given over simply to jobs. And how do we begin to infill and break up the super blocks and make these true mixed-use centers where there's a lot of stuff, not just jobs, or kind of mono uses on one site? We've done a lot of studies on this, and I'll just sort of take one where we looked at six massive suburban activity centers, MXDs, mixed-use centers. And what we found was very significant shares of trips were what we call internal capture. That is, there are people who stayed on site to sort of make trips by foot or bike, and more or less substituting trips, if you have a single-use employment kind of office park, would have been off-site external trips. So you really internalize the trips. But also importantly, you encourage people to take bus or van pools or carpools. If you're going to a single-use activity center in the suburbs, you're virtually stranded out there if you take public transit or van pool. If you put those activities on site, you not only activate the projects and you create activities in the evenings and weekends and make more interesting, better places, but you get a lot of travel efficiencies as well. So this kind of segues into in another context I want to show here in avoiding how do we design cities, and it's an area I've done work in quite a bit over the last three decades. Many of you perhaps are aware that the Washington Metro Rail system are extending the Silver Line out to the Dulles Airport, and they're seizing upon this as an opportunity to transform Tyson's Corner, which is, if you're familiar with Tyson's Corner, it's probably the poster child of auto-oriented kind of mono development. You know, they've got a couple big shopping malls, but it's largely these offices surrounded by parking lots that are disconnected. You can't walk between them. And they're trying to convert this to a kind of transit center corridor. So this is a book I actually wrote in 1989 called American Centers. And Tyson's Corner was one of the case studies. And I call it a concentrated form of strip development, pedestrian hostile, poised for traffic nightmares, and I think that's pretty much been borne out. It really is considered to be one of the more congested activity hubs than the suburbs of anywhere around the world. And of course, with this new metro rail line coming in, they're trying to transform that. How do we actually radically convert this to more of these transit-oriented places? And they're kind of trying to model this, if you're familiar, with the Roslyn-Ballston corridor, where you actually find in this kind of five-kilometer travel shed, five stations, and these are the stations where, kind of like I defined in Curitiba, it's a rail system, but they not only have good density within these five-minute ped sheds of the stations, but they intermix the land uses. So what you get is not only low travel per capita, the VKT per capita of this transit-oriented development is 40% below the regional average, but you do get these 45-55% directional splits in the peak hour. You get a lot of travel efficiencies. So what do we do with a place like Tyson's Corner, which is just towards Dulles Airport from this Roslyn-Ballston corridor? It's 6 square miles. To me, phenomenal. It has 120,000 jobs. That makes it like the sixth largest employment concentration in America, larger than downtown Miami and many other cities. And I find this one statistic, 165,000 parking spaces, just mind-boggling. You know, these urban heat island effects, it's ugly, it creates space, it creates oil stain runoff and streams and water pollution, so a lot of hidden costs associated with excess parking. So, you know, this is what this is the Roslyn-Ballston corridor superimposed upon the boundaries of Tyson's Corner. So it's a huge geographic territory to do this kind of suburban retrofit and master plan. So I worked for about 3 years with Parsons Brinckerhoff placemaking, and our assignment was to do a master plan to do this conversion. So not really fanciful ideas here. We more or less talked about infilling parking lots, stacking up densities, kind of wedding cake style, so a lot of activities were within a five-minute ped shed, but also breaking up the superblock. So an internal bike path system and pedestrian network, and more or less trying to convert what previously would be park and ride activities in the suburbs to walk and ride and bike and ride. And not only the environmental benefits and the energy conservation benefits, but public health benefits and from active transport. So we did a fair amount of modeling of scenarios. What if we proceed with this sort of transformation of Tyson's Corner vis-a-vis business as usual, if more or less Fairfax County continued along the line of sprawl or auto-oriented development? And you know, the models, you can quibble with some of the assumptions, but more or less we came on an order of 25% to 30% reduction in CO2 emissions and VMT reductions and so forth. You know, what you're finding in a place like Tyson's Corner, I think good planning is attracting development in this higher density mixed-use profile, but it's also in the market. More and more people want to live and work and play and learn in these kind of environments, but it won't happen overnight. It took 30 years to be where Tyson's Corner is, and it's probably going to be 30 years to transform it. But, you know, I find it encouraging that these are really robust real estate markets. Every kind of real estate market performance indicator in terms of absorption rates, low vacancy rates, rent premiums suggests there's very high pent-up demand to be in these places. And I kind of like how this one project, Commons of McLean, is being marketed. It says from parking spaces to park spaces, so you know, a nice touch. Okay, so let me shift, given my limited time, very briefly, talk about shift here, and I'm just going to seize upon bus rapid transit. I think a lot of us recognize in terms of where a lot of cities stand with low density spread out development, a lot of trips are not going to be able to support a point-to-point expensive high-capacity metro rail system. We're going to have to take advantage of bus technology, which is an inherently flexible system. The wonderful thing about a BRT system where we have an exclusive dedicated busway is the bus can leave that running way and morph into a feeder. It can collect and distribute people in lower density destinations. So in many ways, you sort of reduce or eliminate the scourge of public transit from a lot of people, and that's making a transfer. You really, within one vehicle, provide point-to-point connectivity. These just happen to be some images of some Australian cities where you can see the low-density landscape and how this technology allows this flexible bus to both do a high capacity line haul service as well as a low density collection distribution service. Chinese cities by far have been the most progressive in advancing BRT. This happens to be some images from Guangzhou, kind of what the buses look like. And when you start running these median lane services and taking buses out of the curbside lane, which is a messy lane, that's where you have people coming in and out of driveways, delivery trucks stopping, a lot of obstructions. You put them on these protected middle lanes, you get a lot more travel efficiency. But the wonderful thing I think they're doing in a place like Guangzhou, they're acknowledging that a lot of growth is low density, spread out, and they're running these open direct line services where, as I said, the buses collect you in a residential area, they then go on the center main line, and then they get off that and take you to a destination, all connected to sort of a multi-centered polycentric settlement pattern. But you can see where the buses converge here. This happens to be 31 bus routes. That's where they're doing kind of transit-oriented development. They're actually where you have this convergence of systems, you have connectivity of the BRT stations with some of the surrounding development, and very significant environmental benefits coming out of that. So let me just kind of end with the third piece of this ASI model, innovate. And you know, many kind of examples one could choose here. I kind of like this one, particularly Seoul smart card system. In Seoul, they've had this for about 7 years now, but and of course they have smart cards where you board the bus, it's got a GPS chip and it can monitor how far you're going. It's a distance-based time of day fare, so it varies by further distance during the peak period, you're gonna pay more. But if you're making a transfer from a bus to a rail, they'll charge an interim fare for the bus trip. Depending how long you wait for the connection, you're gonna, if you have to wait a long time, they're gonna charge you less than a shorter time. And then your final destination on the subway, your final link to the, your final destination on the subway, you're gonna get a final fare. If the subway connection, though, is late, if you have to inordinately wait because the train's slow, you're gonna get a discount. So it's not just marginal cost pricing, it's value pricing. It's the quality of service to the user is being reflected in this technology. And one other example, I'm sure this is gonna come up later, is technology, I think, has been a huge enabler in terms of us to do this sort of dynamic ride-sharing smart microtransit. Systems like UberPool or Lyft lines. The idea is that we can now start filling probably what is the most wasted resource in the urban transport sector, and that's the fact that many cities, 90% of cars have two or three empty seats in them. And if we can start really using technology to fill those by joining people in these kind of real-time dynamic ride-sharing schemes, we really achieve what is probably the most efficient form of mass transportation, collective ride transport, and that's two or three people in a car. So Bogota has this, and this light blue line shows where some of these UberPool services and regular Uber services are with reference to the black line, which is a BRT system, and it's shown to be a complementary system. It's really providing the first, last mile connectivity and filling the gaps unserved. So, you know, there's a lot of debate and controversy whether this is gonna be stealing people out of public transit. I think the evidence is it's probably not. It's gonna be more of a complement. And indeed, if you look at what's happening, including cities like LA, this is a booming market. I think currently UberPool is operating in 30 cities. It's more than 50% of trips, the latest statistics I saw, in San Francisco and Los Angeles, over 100 trips per day. Even APTA, the American Public Transit Association, supports it on the very grounds it's beginning to indoctrinate people to this culture of collective ride transportation. It's not just single occupant vehicles. So their latest statistic is 14% of trips they're serving on UberPool are coming in and out of Metrorail stations. To me, probably what's the most promising thing here, it's very hard to do a dynamic carpool if you're doing door-to-door service with three people. But what we're seeing done is in this graph here is mapping out hotspots where the main destinations are. And if you can start getting people walking one or two blocks to these hotspots, you can really run the algorithms to do much more effective interconnection and dynamic ride sharing. So you get a break in fare, you're gonna pay a lower fare, you're gonna walk a few blocks, but the technology is gonna work a lot more effectively. Now, ultimately what this is about is we're creating more service price points. I mean, the problem in a lot of our urban transportation systems, if you're particularly in the suburbs, you only have two choices. You either drive, or you take a bus that comes by every 20 or 30 minutes and wait 10 or 15 minutes for that bus, or a very expensive taxi. So all of these services are providing these in-between options in terms of prices and service quality that is really in keeping with the vastly changing lifestyle preferences, household structures of many parts of the world. So I think it's all good. It's in keeping. My very last slide, and I think I'm on time here. You know, all of these things avoid through land use planning, shift through sustainable green infrastructure like bikeways and BRT, innovate through technology. We, of course, don't do these in isolation. Density works best where you have good quality public transit. And as I showed in a place like Bogota, if you do things like dynamic ride sharing, it even complements this BRT kind of density. So these things do indeed, they're not separate strategies. They work well in combination. In fact, there was an interesting study a few years ago showing in Portland, Oregon, where they use VMT charges, charging people based on the miles traveled, not the gas miles, the gas consumed. They actually got larger reductions in travel in denser neighborhoods than less dense neighborhoods. So there's clearly interaction going on between these strategies. So obviously, we need a fairly comprehensive, holistic approach towards introducing these things. So my very last quote here is this 2013 UN Habitat Global Report, which I was a co-author, and more or less we concluded, based on these kind of global experiences I very quickly touched on here, is that a pathway towards sustainable, smarter, more livable cities is to create cities where there is shorter distance travel by virtue of better land use management and land use planning, which in turn enables slower modes, more trips by walking and cycling and shared ride, Uber pool or whatever, and of course using technology as smartly and cleanly as we can. So with that, I will close. Thank you for your time.
We next turn to a younger scholar, proving that the universities are doing their jobs and that the next generation is ready to take their place in addressing these complicated issues and adding new dimensions to our understanding of transportation and sustainability. Mike Chester at Arizona State University is co-director of the Urban Resilience to Extreme Events Network. He is director of the Transportation Life Cycle Assessment Network. He's director of the ASU Urban Sustainability Laboratory. And he's a professor in civil, environmental, and sustainable engineering. And his scholarship has influenced my work very directly because he's shown that when considering complicated and important transportation projects, as we are doing in California with the high-speed rail system, it's important to consider the entire life cycle energy implications and emissions implications. And for example, in the high-speed rail program, it may be 25 or 30 years before the first train runs, and we're in the moment, at this moment, when we're under construction, we are consuming a great deal of energy and generating a great deal of greenhouse gas to get to the point where we might in the future have a sustainable system. And he has pointed out more than any other scholar that I'm aware of, that it's important to take into consideration the entire life cycle, and that has had a great deal of influence in our thinking about sustainability and transportation. He's also done a great deal of work on urban development models and has developed some intellectual sustainability frameworks that are influencing the field today. So it's a great pleasure to have Mike Chester with us.
So thank you all. Thank you for the invitation to be here. I'm not going to talk about life cycle assessment today. What I'm going to do instead is focus on what I thought was an interesting question when I was invited to participate here on smart cities, smart technologies, and sustainability. And to me, those two things should mean something. And the question is, what do they mean? And I'm going to explore that a little bit. And I'm going to explore that through three themes that I think are monumentally important in terms of constraining our ability to develop sustainably. I'm going to try to relate it to transportation as much as I can. I think there's definitely broader messages here. The three things that I'm going to talk about are complexity, interdependencies and lock-in of our cities, and whether or not smart cities or smart technologies can help us overcome these three things, moving us more towards sustainability. So, you know, smart cities and sustainability, when you read the program for this session, it says it's about reducing greenhouse gas emissions, right? So I think we've all heard sort of the triple bottom line thinking that there's a dimension of the environment, there's a dimension of social, there's a dimension of the economy in there. We can at least start there in broadening how we think about sustainability. When it comes to sustainable transportation, it's somewhat interesting because when you think about transportation as an activity that is generally associated with increases in well-being, the word is usually welfare, but now that's kind of politically tainted, so I'm going to say well-being. So transportation usually improves overall well-being, but you know, we've come over the past few decades to realize that there are externalities or there are unintended consequences that may impact the broader ways in which we're thinking about sustainability, which from my perspective are universal intergenerational well-being, right? So if we're doing things today in terms of transportation systems that are ultimately impacting the ability of future generations to, live in a sort of fruitful environment, then we need to be rethinking how we're doing things, right? So if we're putting lots of greenhouse gas emissions into the air, if we're consuming resources in ways that they won't be available to us, if we're creating large social inequities in the way that we've structured our cities, our transportation systems, and so on, then we're creating big problems for the future that, may not be worth the small benefits that we get today. So within the context of sustainability, I think there's three sort of key forces here that we need to think about in the context of smart technologies. The first is what I would describe as complexity. Our cities are wildly complex. And when I say complex, I'm distinguishing between complex and complicated, two very different words, okay? So complicated implies that we have some understanding or some estimate of what the emergent behavior is going to be of our decisions or of the way a particular system operates, right? So an airplane composed of millions of parts, if I put those parts on the floor and I say to you, we can assemble these into an airplane, and I ask you, what's the emergent behavior of that airplane? We know what the emergent behavior is. It's going to fly, right? It's going to take off. It's going to be able to stay in the air. It's going to be able to land. It's going to be able to move people in a safe way. Versus complex, which is, if you have all these moving parts that make up a city, some of them are gray infrastructure, some of them are hard infrastructure, some of them are institutional soft infrastructure, and we push and pull levers in the city. If we make decisions in one place, if we put policies in another place, then what's the outcome? What happens in the city overall, especially what happens in the long term? And this becomes a wildly difficult question to answer, right? So cities are complex. And that complexness is not just about a particular system within a city, right? But we can think about the interdependencies of systems, right? So if I say to you, if we have a policy that affects operations of a transit system in Los Angeles, what is going to be the impacts on accessibility? We might be able to answer that. We have a lot of tools, and we have 50 years of research now that allow us to get at some of that stuff. But if I ask you, what's the impact on healthcare, what's the long-term impact on energy resources, right, becomes much murkier, right? It's very difficult to really pick apart and understand what's going to happen. Infrastructure are interdependent. I would argue that infrastructure are becoming increasingly interdependent. I'd say for two main reasons. Over the past 50 years, we've embedded all sorts of information and communication technologies into infrastructure. Think about sensors in roads, think about control systems, think about signaling even. Not only that, but that comes with energy use, right? So our infrastructure are becoming increasingly interdependent, and this creates another major challenge for us in that when we affect one of these infrastructure systems, there's a potential for cascading effects. Not only that, but when there's a vulnerability or when there's a problem in one infrastructure, it has the potential to cascade to other infrastructure systems. And we can't think of these interdependencies purely as hard infrastructure, physical systems that are connected. Infrastructure are very much, our institutions interconnected with the physical systems in which they operate, right? So we have to think about all of these different levers in terms of these interdependencies, which again feeds into this complexity. The third major challenge, I would argue, is what I would call lock-in, or obduracy or path dependency, lots of different words that you see associated with this concept. So our infrastructure and the infrastructure in our cities, whether that be hard or soft, are often locked in, meaning that it's very difficult to change the paths that they're on. They're a big railway locomotive moving at full speed, and to slow it down or to put it on a, you know, more appropriately on a different path is a very difficult thing to do. And it's difficult for a few reasons. One is this obduracy concept that, you know, the way that we've designed cities for a long time is big, heavy things that last a really long time. Infrastructure, hard infrastructure system, roads and buildings, water systems, energy systems last decades, if not, you know, sometimes centuries, right? You're hard pressed to find an example of removing a road from someplace. So there's that inflexibility in terms of the physical infrastructure that's there, and it's there to stay for a long time, which brings up an interesting concept within the context of sustainability. It means that we have to work within this constraint that is this physical infrastructure that we can't change, right? So if we want our cities to look very different, as Bob Cervero just pointed out, we have to deal with this sort of lock-in effect. And how much of the lock-in can we actually remove? So that brings me to an idea of what's called a gating function, right? So are we limited or are we constrained in terms of, for example, how much sustainability we can implement? And that becomes really important because it shifts the dialogue from, you know, mitigating impacts to adapting to impacts, right? Which I would argue is largely where the discourse has moved in the past 10 years, particularly in the context of climate change. Infrastructure is locked in, again, not just because these systems last a long time, but also because they're heavily interwoven, as I just pointed out, with political, economic, social, cultural forces, right? So we have all sorts of signals that we send to keep these infrastructure operating in a particular way, and it becomes very difficult to affect these in a significant way to change these hard infrastructure that have been embedded for a long time. So, where does that leave us? I would argue that there's significant evidence that environmental, economic, and social challenges are not being addressed fast enough. I just mentioned one case. We had an executive order by Obama in 2011, I want to say. I may have the year wrong, where he basically said, we need to start focus on climate change adaptation, to draw one example on the environmental side. And he sent a signal to a lot of scientists and researchers like myself that, yes, we should still be doing greenhouse gas mitigation, but at the same time, we should be thinking about things like adaptation, right? So, you know, it's probably too late to avoid some of the consequences of climate change, and we're going to have to learn how to adapt and live with them, right? So, you know, conversations that you have with climate scientists, they basically say that scenario where greenhouse gas emissions come down very frequently, very fast, there's no reason that's going to happen. In places like California doing great things, Los Angeles doing great things, other places in the US, Europe, around the world are doing great things, I would argue not happening fast enough. Social inequities, I would argue we're not addressing them fast enough. Even sort of economic consequences of the way we've structured our cities in terms of, you know, for example, how much money we spend on transportation, the figure on the right there, fraction of household costs spent on things like transportation, you can get into healthcare sustainability, right? Not decreasing fast enough. So the question is, what do we do about this? So, smart cities. When I was invited to give the talk, I said to myself, what's smart cities? I've been reading about this. I kind of have a sense of what it means. I think it can mean very different things to, you know, very many, to different people in different contexts, and that's fine. But in order to be able to talk about something in 15 minutes, I have to give a definition and talk within at least that context. So the definition that I'm going to use is one that, you know, I would argue is one that you see sort of dominating the discourse around smart cities, or more specifically smart technologies. And that's one of information and communication technologies to manage a city's assets or improve urban services, right? So what are information and communication technologies? One, they're very technocentric. I'm going to talk about that and the significance of that in a minute. But we start with telecommunication networks, so things like fiber optic lines, hardware associated with that. That's essentially the nerves of the system, right? Then you get into the sensors, right? And that's what's taking in data, what's sensing, what's going on out there, maybe producing data. And lastly, the software component, right? And that's the techno-human piece, right? That's where humans interact with the system directly, right? So we have things like ride-sharing apps that are popping up. We have transit agencies and transportation agencies that are producing all sorts of data and providing it, you know, through the Google Transit feed specifications or something like that, and making it readily available to software developers to do all sorts of innovative things, ultimately to improve knowledge, right? Knowledge of how our city's working. You see where this is going related to complexity, interdependencies, and lock-in. And ultimately, I would argue cognition, right? How is it that we learn and understand what is happening in our city, right? So within the context of these three, right, the question then becomes, how can smart technologies help address these three challenges that I've identified, and there are probably many more, ultimately leading towards transportation sustainability? So, you know, the first is complexity. How different systems, how people, how policies, how infrastructure, hard and soft, interact. What is the nature of that interaction is ultimately what's going on with complexity, right? So things like information access, social network analytics, like how people are interfacing with infrastructure, with transportation systems, offers tremendous potential of peeling back the layers of complexity, helping us understand what's going on in these systems, how people are using them, how they're functioning, what the effects are way downstream of a policy or decision, change in operations, something like that, to all sorts of things that are happening upstream with ultimately how people are using it and ultimately the sustainability of that. Interdependencies. I think there's two ways to think about interdependencies and smart technologies and sustainability. The first is that we're going to have more interdependencies, as I argued. You know, we're going to have more embedding of information and communication technologies in our dumb systems, right, in our older systems that don't have these things. Right, and our ability to comprehend what that means, I would argue, we're nowhere near understanding that. Nowhere near. This gets to the sort of human cognition part of it, ultimately the techno-human condition, right? I don't think we're anywhere near being able to comprehend what, you know, something that will soon have the processing power of a cat's brain in our pocket will be able to do for us in terms of how we understand the city. But the other side of things, greater transparency and interactions between existing systems. I think it's going to, again, peel back the layers of how these systems interact, whether it's through infrastructure sensing, onboard vehicle systems, data collection, and so on. I think we're going to be able to see much more clearly information that in the past wasn't digitized or wasn't available to, you know, outside of a single organization is going to be available to us at our fingertips. And lastly, lock-in. I think there's lots of potential here. I think sort of two ways to think about this. Illuminate steps for breaking path-dependent systems. So, you know, you can think about the public participation process, which I would argue, you know, when we are trying to make major decisions about how to change infrastructure to make it more sustainable, the public participation process hasn't really evolved, hasn't really developed in how long? 50 years, a century, something like that, right? We have these meetings every so often, right? So now we have these information communication technologies, e-participation, the ability to sort of communicate and interact with you know, the decision makers that are affecting these infrastructure systems in ways that we've never seen before. I think that's huge. But I think smart technologies themselves could offer new paths, right? So I think information and communication technologies are implicitly virtual technologies, right? So they're going to, by themselves, offer the potential of eliminating physical mobility for certain types of activities that don't necessarily require physical mobility, right? We've seen bits and pieces of evidence of this already. The Anthropocene is an important word. It's a word that describes the period. It's not a not an agreed upon term of when this starts, but it's the period of when humans started having major influence over the environment. You know, when we started majorly affecting the environment, so past 100, 200 years, something like that. I would argue that the Anthropocene is one that's going to be characterized with high unpredictability, right? We're already seeing evidence of this with extreme events when you talk about the environmental dimension. We're seeing how people are affected, the unpredictability of how people are affected by extreme events in the environment. And as Marty started by saying, he can't get out of here because you know, we've got all sorts of fast, rapid, transformative technologies that are coming into place, right, that are also highly unpredictable in terms of what they can do and what effects they're gonna have. This means that we're gonna need to design our systems with the agility and flexibility to be able to respond to this unpredictability. I think it's another major challenge, but it's one that smart technologies can certainly help with. Ultimately, I don't view these smart technologies as transitional in and of themselves. They're not going to lead to sustainability by themselves. That would be my argument here. Yes, I think there's great potential for them to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, improve energy efficiency, to help us understand what's going on in the system and help us make smarter decisions. But they're highly technocentric. And technologies, as we've seen over and over and over again, technocentric solutions don't by themselves deal with wicked problems, and sustainability is a wicked problem. So I think that smart technologies are part of a broad suite of strategies that we're going to want to employ, some technocentric, some non-technocentric, to help us move towards sustainability. With that, thank you very much.
The final speaker is Eran Feitelson. He is a professor of geography at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, has been doing research for decades on the relationships between urban settlements, land use, behavior patterns, and in addition to his academic work, he was an administrator. He's been chair of the Department of Geography at Hebrew University, and he's been head of the Fetterman School for Public Policy and Government at the Hebrew University. He also chaired the Israeli National Parks and Nature Reserves Council for 10 years, and his work focuses on land use and water resources, and he's going to address us this morning as well. Eran Feitel.
Okay, thank you. I'll be talking about sustainable transport, but I'll try to look at the different dimensions of sustainability. And we must remember that sustainability has more than one dimension, which has already been mentioned before. Coming from the Middle East, I add a fourth dimension, which is usually not talked about, that of security. If, I mean, you were thinking about what we talk about sustainable transport in Baghdad, well, you would begin with security, because if you don't have security, everything else it simply won't be. So now when we talk also, another point I want to make when we talk about the intragenerational equity, we usually talk at it from a Rawlsian perspective. That is, that we look at the weakest stratas in society, and we have to take them into account when we talk about sustainable transport. And because when we talk about sustainable transport, the kind of motherhood and apple pie sustainable transport, which we all agree to, you know, we would talk about reduced emissions, provide accessibility opportunities to all, and of course the important word here is to all, is that last two words. We would like to promote economic development, however measured, we talk about well-being, happiness, not just GDP, decoupled from resource intensiveness, and we would like to do it without compromising security, and transport and security have close relationships. Actually, Mike touched upon it. However, life is not that simple because there are some trade-offs and contradictions between the different dimensions, sometimes also within dimensions, because when we propose different measures, and you already heard here about a lot of measures, they don't always live well together, and sometimes one measure comes at the expense of another measure, all geared for the same purpose. And sometimes the contradictions are even wider. Now, what I'll do is simply give a few examples of these contradictions. And one of them, and I'll be using Israeli examples, one of them is, for example, between public transport investments. Because one idea, and I mean anybody who talks about sustainable transport will talk about public transport, and the purpose, if you want to reduce CO2 emissions, of course, is to take drivers out of the cars into public transport. At the same time, public transport is crucial for those who don't have cars, which in other societies other than the United States can be substantial portions of the population. Now, that doesn't always go together very well, and I'll give an example in a moment. Another example, let's say you see it in Europe, is, for example, the investments in rail. Again, rail is usually considered as this pro-sustainable and good practice, et cetera, et cetera. Are we talking about high-speed rail or local rail and regional rail? There's a big difference between them. And the kind of big buzz is about high-speed rail. Who does public high-speed rail serve vis-a-vis who does local and regional networks serve? And there's a big difference between who is served by one system and who is served by another system. And where do the investments go? Well, they go to the high-end users, not to the low-end users. And I'll show it in two examples in Israel now. One of them is the Tel Aviv fast lane services. This is a park and ride between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. You see it on the map below. You see it on the pictures on the top. Essentially, people come, park their car, get on the shuttle, and go to Tel Aviv. The shuttle is free, the parking is free, and the BOT agreement, the operator gets funded by the number of cars who park in the parking lot. And there's also a bus route, which is an exclusive bus route at the top, which also goes to Tel Aviv. Wonderful. It works perfectly. The occupancy is, they're now talking about the second story of parking because the parking is full. It takes people out of the cars, environmentally excellent. Whom does it serve? There's another system there. You can't see it there. On the right-hand picture, or the top right-hand corner, you see a single bus standing there. That bus is not going to Tel Aviv. It is going to Jerusalem. What happens is that's a new service that has been put in place. Essentially, people can come and park coming from the Tel Aviv metropolitan region or take the transit out, get on this bus. What does this bus do? It does not go into a central bus station. It goes directly to the government offices and to universities. Who is using that bus service? We had students looking into these questions. People sitting on that bus almost exclusively read Haaretz. It would be the similar of people reading the New York Times, all the bus reading the New York Times, which says what population it serves. Haaretz is very small circulation of the total newspaper reading public. And there's other bus services. We go, for example, from central bus station to central bus station. About a third of the users don't speak Hebrew at all. There's a class difference between the two bus systems. Where are the investments? These type of buses. They're with Wi-Fi, they're better buses, and that's the services which are expanding. Where does it come at the expense of? Where the frequency goes down? The central bus station to central bus station system. So this whole success is a middle class success. It is geared to middle class users, to the drivers and to the people who go to the universities, to the government, etc., to the New York Times readers. This whole system is geared to them. Who is not geared to? To those without cars, to the low class, lower classes, this whole system. Now this is going to expand. We're going to have similar systems all around Tel Aviv metropolitan area. As I said, the second story, more transit lines, more kind of exclusive buses going to universities and government offices, et cetera, et cetera. This is what's growing. Here are the investments when we talk already in the bus system. What happens in the rail system? First of all, the left-hand side is the investments of the Ministry of Transport, taken from the Ministry of Transport site. And you can look at the percentages, 26% on road, 46.5% of the investments in the site are for rail. And BRT, which Robert talked about earlier, is 4.6%. Who is the rail geared for? That's the right hand. I took all the stations. Israel is a small country, and so it's easy to count all the stations and which towns they serve. It's only municipalities. They looked at the deciles of the socioeconomic decile and which percent of each groups of deciles is served by a rail. And what you can see is that it's geared again, middle class and up. These are the ones which are served by rail. Who is not served by rail? The lower deciles. In our case, many of the Arab jurisdictions, ultra-Orthodox jurisdictions, where the reliance on public transport is much greater. So what we see in the combination of these two tables, essentially, when we invest already in rail, when we invest in public transport, who do we invest for? For the middle class. We don't invest for the carless. We're not investing for the weaker stratas of society. So we have here one of these trade-offs between dimensions. From an environmental perspective, excellent. From a social perspective, well, not exactly. Another issue that is coming up now, we're talking about autonomous vehicles, Mobileye plus Waze, Israeli inventions, GPSs and all the applications. are of that kind. We're moving towards the autonomous car. It has a lot of potential. It has a lot of benefits. This can serve the ones without cars, because you could have the car come and pick you up and go on. You can be blind, you can be a child, you can be elderly, and you can use the autonomous vehicle because you don't need to drive. It's very good in terms of servicizing, the idea that you don't need to own a car, but you just get the mobility services. So that's also another potential benefit. It improves greatly the utilization of road space, which in a dense country like Israel is very important, because cars can be closer if you have more, if they're all moving without drivers, without the human element in them, and with the mobile eye, et cetera, et cetera. So you can have the cars much denser, much better utilization of the road space, improved safety, improved emissions once you move that into also alternative fuel type of vehicles. However, what does it do for public transport and mass transit? That's not that clear. We haven't really looked into that question that much. What does it do for non-vehicular travel? For example, how do you cross the road when everyone is bumper to bumper? It is that kind of questions is the questions that actually come up once you've moved into this type of a brave new world. So it is has a lot of benefits, but there are also some questions which actually we have to start thinking about when we're talking about it. Another thing we're talking about is the importance of flexibility. When we talk about a post-industrial economy and the lifestyles that we have to a household, to worker households, et cetera, which is, we're there already, we're talking about the importance of flexibility. Flexibility is the key, actually, when we talk about from an economic and social perspective. What does flexibility mean? Again, autonomous vehicles, cars, et cetera, so we can move in various times, in various places, in various directions, polycentricity, et cetera, it doesn't go that well with the mass transit ideas. And these kind of, how to bring these two together. I mean, the previous two lectures, you already heard about all kinds of new ideas on how to actually round that square or square that round, whatever you, whichever way you want. The issue of densification, which was already, Robert raised it very well, which is very conducive for public transport, conducive for non-vehicular trips. It is improves accessibility. And is conducive for protection of open spaces, which is a central issue in the Israeli scene or in the European scene. But, and this is not my work, this is Yoram Shiptan's work, what we see is also that the number of trips increases, which is socially good, mainly of the non-work related trips, but it does not necessarily translate to lower VMT, vehicles mild travel, because of the additional number of trips. So it's the question is again, there's questions here, there's some major benefits, but it does not necessarily produce all everything that we would have liked to do. The last, just kind of, I'm just talking bullet points, the security issue. In terms of security, what we would want is screening. Anybody who goes into an airport, you know what we mean when we talk about what does security do. You know, we stand and take our shoes off and watches off, et cetera, et cetera. And that comes at a price. It's the contradiction to transport, because transportation is about flows and how to improve the flows and reduce the friction of, reduce friction. Security increases the friction. Sometimes you need also to separate flows. You want to separate flows by different people, et cetera, et cetera. In cargo cases, Marty mentioned the cargo before, so that's also an issue. We need security means differentiation, screening, et cetera. We talked about integrated systems, so integrated systems, again, you want very rapid movement from one system to another, from rail to buses, from buses to airports, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All that is compromised when you start talking about security, and you have to say, well, I want to see who is going and what does he have, he or she has on them, et cetera. And so this is another trade-off that we have to talk about when we're talking about transport. So what can be done? This is the last slide. I'm really trying to rush it. First of all, when we talk about sustainability, there's no panaceas. And there's no let's just do this or that. You can't have that. By necessity, We'll be talking about a large combination of measures. And now any of the measures we're using is likely to have externalities. So the externality is not just something we're trying to address by using various policy measures. When we use the policy measures, we create other externalities, maybe on another dimension. It could be that we're improving really in terms of CO2 emissions, but it has social ramifications. So we have to look at these type of externalities of the policies themselves, which means we need to build policy packages. And this is actually the type of research we're doing today, is talking about policy packages. How can you combine policy measures in order to be, at the first level, more effective? That is, to address the different goals of sustainability. And for that, we've developed approaches on how to analyze large combinations of measures in order to package them together to be effective. However, effectiveness is not enough, because we live in a world where there's politics involved, and politics are inherent and good in the sense that there's different tensions and different things that you can or cannot do because they're politically acceptable or politically unacceptable or socially acceptable or socially unacceptable. And so you want the policy package is not something which is theoretical. It's not something that you just want to write a paper about. It's something that you want to happen on the ground. The point is really the implementation. And in order to get the implementation, it has to be acceptable. So we have a second level of, or it's actually a third level, I won't go into the details, where we talk about the acceptability of the different measures. That is, you have to assess the political actors and the different actors and the amount of opposition the measures and the packages receive. And so we often would end up in a second best package, but which has a chance of being implemented, is better than a first best package, which will not get implemented. So you don't try for the first best necessarily, you're trying for what can be implemented. And it's better to do something than to do to go for optimum. And this is the direction that we're talking about, how to actually have a viable, acceptable packages. Now, these packages are not easily transferable. You have to differentiate both spatially and temporally because new ideas come along, so you have to adjust these packages, but also you would have to have them in different places. We had a project, a European project, where we had one of the, we talked about, was about service-sizing, really. One of the things was about service-sizing in transport, and so we had a team that was Oxford-based, which looked at the transport part of it. Then we looked at different countries. We had four countries in which we tried to, and we had to adapt the packages and change them according to the political and social structure of and legal structure of the different countries. So ultimately, we need to have place time-sensitive packages, which is the way we can perhaps start to move forward. So that would be all. Thank you.
So in a moment, I'm going to invite questions and comments from the floor. I'd like to use the moderator's prerogative and ask the first question, but I'll only ask one. Most of the three presentations dealt with land use and changes in travel behavior, in human behavior. At the same time that we're addressing these, we're also making enormous changes in transportation technology and cleaner fuels, and, for example, substituting natural gas for liquid petroleum fuels, and we're also moving toward electric vehicles and so on. And the more we have cleaner vehicles, the more we have fewer emissions per vehicle mile or trip, the less return we get from changes in land use and from modal shifts to public transit. In a Transportation Research Board special report that Robert Cervero was part of writing, they pointed out that the data would show that about somewhere between 11 and 15% of the gain that we're hoping to get can come from behavioral changes, with the rest coming primarily from technology. I would like to ask at least one or two of the panelists to comment on this interaction and the challenges that it places on the kinds of approaches that they were talking about. Clearly, there are co-benefits. There are other things that we benefit from in our society from changing land use and travel behavior beside greenhouse gas emissions. But the role of technology wasn't emphasized as much as the change in urban form. And I would like the panelists to comment on that. Who would like to?
Well, I'll just make one brief comment. You know, I think you're certainly right. To the degree technology provides higher value added, the benefits that accrue from urban form, good planning are going to be somewhat diminished. But I think for the most part, these are kind of compatible reinforcing approaches. You know, obviously nothing has more energy density than fossil fuel. When you start going to alternative systems, particularly electric systems, you do have more constrained mobility. But some of the ideas that I kind of very briefly touched on are essentially trying to create cities where we create shorter to more intermediate distance trips. And where we really see the sweet spot, for instance, of public transit, where it really grabs high market shares, are a lot of trips in these kind of 4 to 10 kilometer distances. Shorter than that, a lot of people can walk and bike. Longer than that, it's too many intermediate stops they're going to drive. So if you can create these intermediate kinds of trip distances through density and land use planning, these more intermediate technologies that don't have the range and the energy density of traditional fossil fuel systems are probably going to be more enabled, along with better pricing and so forth. So yes, there are inherently some contradictions and some trade-offs on all of these, but I think if you really carefully unpack some of these, you begin to see a lot of compatibilities in approaches.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment?
Maybe I'll just say that, I mean, in terms of reducing the CO2 emissions, yes, technology obviously has the greatest probability and the greatest benefits, but as I was talking about, you know, sustainable transport is more than CO2. And once you bring that into account, that is, I think, where the big benefits of the land use and planning come to play.
Okay. Mike, you want
to? So I agree. There's, you know, we've done a lot of sort of integrated transportation land use life cycle modeling. And when you look at the effects of, life cycle effects of shifts from kind of lower density, auto-centric, urban form to higher density transit, you know, active transport forms, what you tend to find is that the latter requires more embedded energy investment up front, right? So you are required to put in, you know, bigger structures, heavier structures that have a higher energy